Someday, to score the winning goal in a major cup final is something every soccer player dreams of. Including Christian Gruer, aged 9. Scoring the winning goal in a Gothia Cup final is a first important step towards fulfilling that dream. Pequeninos from Sao Paulo, Brazil, have arrived in Gothenburg to participate in the world's largest soccer tournament as part of a two-month tour of Europe. They have traveled a long way, and they are tired. Very tired. Drøbak Frong hailed from Norway. The school they'll be staying in is the same as last year. To them, and to many others, Gothia Cup is more than merely football. It's the event of the year. Volunteers from Brescia, Italy, they are here to win, according to their trainer, Roberto Clerici. This is an important tournament. Nothing is allowed to interfere with the preparations. That's why they are staying in a hotel. Like most of the other 18,000 Gothia participants, Pequeninos' complement of 40 are staying in one of the many schools vacated for the summer holidays. Who cares if the surroundings aren't exactly luxurious when the only thing you are concerned with is soccer? Brazil is a great soccer nation. Didi, Vavá, Pelé, Zico. This is Augusto. Augusto Guerra Mendes, Pequeninos' star striker. For Drøbak Frong, discipline isn't always the main thing. Being happy is, even in the midst of what could only be described as controlled chaos. Volunteers are relaxing before their first practice session, and 11-year-old Stefano Achetti is writing a letter home to Italy. He's been to Sweden twice before, and he has also been to the United States and France. He's sure that Italy will win the World Cup this time. Stefano's main ambition in life is to become a professional with one of the major Italian clubs. He's convinced that if you have a goal in life, you have to be prepared to make big sacrifices. That's the way he is, Stefano. And despite being only 11, he's already very much a professional. Katrin Boland is 14 years of age and has only been playing football for 1 year. She claims she has the best trainer in the world, Harald Skoglund, ex-boxer, yachtsman and professional trainer. To him, the team and working together are the most important thing. And he feels that at this level, winning should be a secondary consideration. The main thing is to enjoy yourself. And that means doing many different things, not just playing football. The age check for participating in the Gothia Cup, however, is mandatory for everyone. Meanwhile, Pequeninos are being briefed by the club's founder and trainer, José Guimarães. Everyone listens attentively to what he has to say. Well, almost everyone. Roberto Clerici, too, is the founder and creator of his club, Volantis. His players are trained at a quick pace and nearly always with a ball. Although Robert Clerici has standing offers from many of the top Italian clubs, he feels that the best material is to be found among young people, and the boys worship him, despite the fact that he has a tendency to raise his voice. Ball control. Always ball control. Up. Franco Pizzotti is responsible for Volanta's equipment. Next to him on the bench is Gunnar Grimm, the Swedish ex-footballer who made a big name for himself as a professional in Italy. He's a keen supporter of Volanta's. In another part of Gothenburg, Drøbak is about to start practice. Harald Skoglund's final instructions are for the team to enjoy themselves. To be sure, they take him literally. proving, as always, that laughter is contagious.
Okay. Grå, du blir redd. De andre fire går ut og dere inn som angrep.
Playing matches is our best teacher. Competitiveness, our worst enemy. That's how Harold puts it. Drøbak don't always feel their best side. In this team, everyone plays. The idea isn't Harold's. It was decided by the girls themselves. A final run-through and the final practice session before the first match. This is the first day of Gothia Cup, and high time to attend the opening ceremony. The opening is Olympic in format. 804 teams from 38 different countries. Just like in the Olympic Games, all the participants take a special oath in a number of different languages.
Nosotros, los jóvenes de todo el mundo, prometemos jugar y vivir juntos durante esta semana con deportividad y camaradería. Declaramos abierta la Gothia Cup de 1989.
Nous joueurs du monde promettons de jouer et vivre ensemble au nom de l'amitié et de la sportivité. Nous déclarons maintenant la Gothia Cup 1989 ouverte.
Finally, it's time for the kickoff. 2,800 matches on 42 pitches. A few on gravel, most of them on grass. And at the very heart of it all, hidden right in the center of Gothenburg. Bolivians against Brazilians. Peruvians against Swedes. Some get off to a bad start. And the tears are never far away. The girls from Taiwan are definitely a side to be reckoned with. Nimble Israelites pit their skill against the somewhat slower Swedes. It's as easy to surrender the ball as it is to lose heart, especially when everything can be chalked up to bad luck, pure and simple. The most difficult thing, however, is to keep track of all the goals. Bad attendance figures, not at Heden and certainly not at Gothia Cup. For the locals, this is a major event. Leif Sandell is one of the 180 referees in the tournament. He has refereed many Swedish league matches and a number of European Cup finals. As far as he is concerned, Gothia Cup is a perfect way of keeping fit. 900 officials, including interpreters for 474 teams from all over the world, thousands of matches, and tens of thousands of goals to keep track of. But it's done, and it's done well. Rescheduling of matches, changed venues, teams who have shown up too late for a match, someone who has lost his passport, a massive stream of queries. The newspapers, radio and television. For some, the tournament has hardly begun before it's over. Plaster casts and crutches. Casualties are treated by some of Sweden's foremost specialists on sports injuries, one of whom is Dr. Leif Svärd. For the Swedish team, Monka Ljungby, things don't look good at all. 13 goals down. But what can you do when faced with a Thai team drilled to perfection? Especially when your goalkeeper is the team's best player. Nothing can save Drøbak from disaster. Not Harald Skoglund, nor the Norwegian flag, nor the vociferous support of enthusiastic parents. Things look very black indeed. But you wouldn't know it from looking at them. The atmosphere is more like a picnic. Harald sitting calmly in his chair, and only rarely does he shout. He isn't interested in the result as such. A well-played 45 minutes is ample compensation for losing by a couple of goals. Drøbak don't get much opportunity to score. This is the closest they get. After two losses and one draw, they drop out of the tournament. But no one seems to be particularly depressed about it. In fact, they leave the pitch looking as if they had won, not lost. Meanwhile, Augusto and his mates in Pekaninos are warming up for a decisive match. Trainer Gaucho is worried. After a surprise defeat, they have to win this one if they are to reach the finals. Also worried is the team's ever-present interpreter, Lewis. The opposing team is Neumünster. As team captain and the star of the team, Augusto has to shoulder the burden of showing the way to victory. Hope is kindled as he puts his team in the lead 1-0. But the surge of optimism fades quickly as a German free kick evens the score. Gaucho is, to say the least, desperate. But the match belongs to Augusto, and he scores again despite intensive attempts to stop him. It's the sort of thing that you can probably only learn to do well in Brazil. Pequeninos make it to the finals. As do Volantas after two initial victories. Now they are about to face the Swedish team Backlöra, and not even Roberto Clerici is particularly worried. Despite the fact that he is 2 years younger than the rest and considerably shorter, the midfield is dominated by Stefan. There is no way of stopping him. Stefano Italiani, Volanta's leading scorer, nets one of his team's 11 goals. What else can you do but let him? It's a magnificent display, to the sheer delight of the football-loving spectators. And Sven Rune Lindqvist, who has refereed football for over 38 years, claims that Volantas is the best boys' team he has ever seen. How do you go about feeding 18,000 hungry football players? Is it possible to get the Chinese to actually like Swedish sausage? Or persuade Bolivians to eat cold veal broth? It's important to prepare food that everyone likes. 260,000 meals and 83,000 liters of milk. Katrine and her teammates prefer the food they get back home in Norway. But at least here, they don't have to do the washing up. Whilst other teams might land themselves with an extra practice session after losing a match, Harald Skoglund has a different method. He takes his girls out on the town. And there they find Scandinavia's largest amusement park, Liseberg. And as expected, at Liseberg, they run into some other players from Gothia Cup. A pleasant alternative to Liseberg is to take a stroll along the main street, Avenue. During this particular week in July, all of Gothenburg is very much the home of Gothia Cup. At the leaders' get-together, there are plenty of opportunities for the trainers to meet their opposite numbers from Asia, Africa, and South and North America to discuss the pros and cons of various tactics and training methods, to get acquainted. And to partake of that special seaside atmosphere that's so typically Swedish. And Harald takes the opportunity to plug Norway and Norwegian oil. Meanwhile, Katrine and the other Drobeck girls drop in at the huge Gothia disco, where thousands of young people from all over the world crowd the floor. Thirty-eight different languages might stand in the way of communication, but dancing is a language everyone understands. Augusto from Brazil celebrates his team's qualifying for the finals on the dance floor. And in the crowd, he finds Katrine from Norway. Two days later, the party is over for Augusto. Pequeninos are in the quarterfinals against Viedo, also from Brazil. The match is to be decided by penalty kicks. And the hero of 2 days ago becomes today's scapegoat. Augusto misses the decisive penalty. And no matter whether he's destined to become a member of the national team or a world champion, this is one penalty he'll never forget. Volantes, too, has problems, big problems. In their semi-final, they are pitted against the Bob Higgins Soccer Academy from England, who have got the Norwegians rooting for them. Roberto Clarici is tense and far from satisfied. At the end of extra time, the score is 1-1. The match will be decided by penalty kicks. Even Clarici is tempted to look away at the crucial moment. Stefano and the ref have a bone to pick. Stefano is far too tense to express his exhilaration. The English goalkeeper, however, is unable to hold back his tears. Volunta's goalkeeper moves into position for the clinch. Volunta's is in the final. Although Augusto and his team didn't make it past the quarterfinals, Pecchinino's younger team has gone all the way and their samba band is warming up for the match, whilst other teams are packing and preparing for their journey home. Despite everything, Gaucho is pleased that one of his teams has reached the finals. Pecaninos against the Swedish team Vestra Frill. The Brazilians are very much in command throughout the match. A well-deserved 1-0 becomes 2-0, and the cup is raised to the skies. A victory for the entire club. And Augusto smiles happily again. In the youngest class, 10-year-olds, 7-a-side, Ashim Sweden meets Tel Aviv, Israel, in what turns out to be one of the best matches of the entire tournament. After only a few seconds, Patrick Bernvid gains possession and scores. The Israelis are furious as Patrick is cheered by his team in a gamut of triumph. Moments later, the roles are reversed. Ashim, however, win the day. The goals they score are straight out of the textbook, and the victory sign is copied from the major cup final. The final score is 4-3, and it's difficult to say who's the happiest, the parents, the trainers, or the boys themselves. But then again, a joy that's shared is a joy made double. One of the girls' finals stood between two Swedish teams, Västerås BK and Lindum. Here, too, the goals are all by the book. 1-0 to Västerås becomes 3-0 and unbounded happiness for the victors. And Katrin congratulates the winners. Volantis and East Boys from Scotland line up for the final. Stefano is extremely nervous. 20,000 spectators in the stands. 20,000 to watch a football match between two boys' teams. The match begins. Stefano receives the ball. And a short rebound pass and a forward slice to Stefano Tagliani, who coolly rolls in 1-0. The Italians are delirious with joy, but it's far too early to take a victory for granted. There's plenty of time remaining. The East Boys are a very good side, and it's a well-known fact that Scots never say die, and that applies even if they're only 13 years old. They pounce on every little mistake their opponents make, and suddenly it's 1-1. Roberto Clerici is displeased, to say the least. A penalty. Stefano cannot believe his eyes nor the decision. As cool as you please, and it's 2-1 to the Scots. And now, time is beginning to run out for Volantis. Especially since the Scottish goalkeeper has turned into a veritable lion at the gates. And a good thing too, since he isn't getting all that much help from the defence. At this stage, Clarity is definitely beyond help. Winners and losers. It's always the same. Stefano keeps a straight face, but some of the others can't keep back the tears. But one of the things they teach you early on in Volantis is the importance of being a good loser. And now, over to this year's main event, the final between Tauichi from Bolivia with 800 matches played and only 3 defeats, and Hajduk Split from Yugoslavia. At full time, the score is 1-1, and as we move into the extra time, Hajduk goes on the attack. And for a long time, it looks as if the winning goal has been scored. The cup is practically on board the plane to Yugoslavia. Only seconds remain when the gods intervene on behalf of Tauichi. The match is to be decided by penalty kicks. All 22 players know that somewhere among them, there is a loser. Tauichi has missed a penalty. Hajduk are in a position to take the lead. One loser, one winner. The score is even again. Now it's Tauichi's turn to take the lead. No hesitation here. And only inches from being saved. This time, he's a loser. At least in his own eyes. The roles keep changing. Now it's the Yugoslav goalkeeper's turn, perhaps, to become a hero. And he succeeds. Now it's up to the Yugoslavs. One penalty left. And it belongs to Hajduk Split. A handshake. Possibly an attempt to unnerve his opponent. The sign of the cross. No mistake, no mercy. The victory sign. And he's dubbed Hero of the Day. Tauichi, the reigning Gothia Cup champions, are toppled from the throne. Long live the new champions, at least until next year's Gothia Cup. This year, Christian Gruer was too young for Gothia Cup, but next year he'll be playing. So it's high time for him to start practicing the victory sign.
Citizens of